Good morning. Welcome. Stand and sing together of our great King and his love, his mercy, and his might.
From the ground, a broken world cries out for healing, mercy to arise. And flowing from above, such glory wrapped in love, the King of heaven comes to rescue us.
Hallelujah to the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, for his wonderful, marvelous love for you and for me.
I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned by me. Oh,
Savior's love. My God, let him be made known. Behold, our God.
He has held the oceans in his hands. Who has numbered every grain of sand? Kings and nations tremble at his voice. All creation rises to rejoice.
Who has given? Our living waters.
Are you thirsty? Are you empty? Come and drink these living waters. Tired and broken, peace unspoken, rest beside these living waters.
Christ is calling.
Christ is calling. Find refreshing at the cross of living waters. Lay your life down, all the old God. Rise up in these living waters.
There's a river. There's a river.
Thank you.
again, are you thirsty?
Are you thirsty? Are you empty? Come and drink these living waters. The forgiveness, vast and boundless, Christ, He is our living water.
Sing, there's a God, all that He has done, all that He has given, sing hallelujah, praise Him, see the destined day arise.
See the destined day arise, see a willing sacrifice, Jesus to redeem our lives, lives upon the shameful cross, Jesus who
good morning. What a delight to hear these songs that are pointing us to the upcoming Easter season. Hard to believe we're just 1 month away. And I'd like to go ahead and point your attention to these invitational tickets that you'll find outside on the tables outside of our auditorium. If you have an opportunity, pick some up, because this is the time of year that if you extend an invitation to someone to come to church, they will be more receptive than any other time. Now, if you're visiting with us for the first time, I want to wish you a very warm welcome, whether you're here in Beaufort or perhaps in Bluffton or Graniteville or at our Gray's campus or around the world on the internet watching us by live stream, a very special welcome to you. And if this is your first time, I'd point your attention to the seat back pocket in front of you where you'll find this Connect card. If you will fill that out at the end of the service, put it in the offering. That will allow us to send you some information about us. Now, why not find somebody near you and wish them a very warm CBC welcome?
Remain standing, sing with us of the hope, the certainty, the sure thing that our Savior is alive.
Thank you for the cross where you saved me. Thank you for the love that forgave me. When I was far away, you were reaching out for me. Alive in me, I have hope.
our God. You may take your seats this morning as we continue.
Sing the power to save. I wonder how many times we've sung about the cross of Jesus Christ and the power to save and our salvation. And I wonder, in the midst of doing all those songs and how many times we celebrate the Lord's Supper, if we've lost the sense of the wonder of it all, the wonder of our salvation. We're going to talk about that this morning, but before we do, pray with me, would you? Our Father and our God, on this Sunday morning, we celebrate the reality of Christ and our salvation and the forgiveness of our sins. But Father, I think we'd have to confess that in some ways we've lost the wonder of that, the wonder of that great miracle of our salvation, that you would die for us and save us from our sins and give us a relationship with you in eternal life. My prayer today, that you would take us back and remind us afresh of the wonder of it all, and take us back and remind us of that last supper that Jesus Christ had with his disciples, and speak to us today and change us. Come, Father, because unless you come, nothing will happen. And we pray in Christ's name. Amen. Today, I want to talk to you about the last supper. That is the last supper that Jesus Christ had with his disciples the night before he was crucified. And to start that off, I want to ask you a question. How many of you on the way to church this morning said to someone or thought to yourself, I hope Pastor Bennett preaches on the last supper of Jesus Christ? I don't see any hands, and that's why I kind of expect it. It's not one of those that's high in our list of needs or sermons we like to hear. And yet I would tell you that it ought to be. I would tell you that until we understand the Last Supper of Jesus Christ, we're not ready to celebrate the Lord's Supper that we're going to do at the end of this service. But I also would tell you that there's a lot of lessons about life that are found in the Last Supper of Jesus Christ. But I also, see, I found that in Christianity as a whole, and I think even within this body of believers in our own lives, we've lost the wonder of our salvation. We've lost the joy and the wonder of it all. And I truly believe that the way to rediscover the wonder of our salvation and the wonder of our Christian life is to go back and to look at the Last Supper of Jesus Christ. And I'm thinking, if the Last Supper is that important, then we need to examine it this morning, whether we came expecting or hoping to hear about it or not. So join me, if you will, in Mark chapter 14. Mark chapter 14 and a last meal together. Now, my purpose is simple this morning. My purpose is to help us to examine the Last Supper of Jesus Christ and to understand what it was all about. There's a lot that was taking place that night. But my purpose is also so that we might have our hearts prepared to celebrate the Lord's Supper, but maybe to again find the wonder of our salvation and the wonder of all that Christ has done for us. To do that, in Mark chapter 14, notice we want to break this passage down into three parts. And I want to begin in verse 12 with the celebration of Passover, because that's what Christ and his disciples have gathered together to do on this, for this Last Supper. It's a celebration of the Passover. Join me in verse 12. It says, on the first day of unleavened bread, when the Passover lamb was being sacrificed, that Christ, Jesus' disciples, said to him, where do you want us to go and prepare for you to eat the Passover? Now notice here in verse 12, it mentions the Passover. And I'm curious this morning, what do you remember about the Passover and the history of the Jewish people? Well, maybe you remember that the Jewish people were in bondage as slaves in Egypt for hundreds of years, and they cried out to God. And God heard their cries, heard their prayers, and so he came and he called upon Moses to lead the people of the Israelites out of the bondage of Egypt. And he says, Moses, I want you to go and tell Pharaoh, let my people go. And Moses went to Pharaoh and said, God said, let my people go. And Pharaoh refused to do it. And so God brought a series of plagues upon Pharaoh and the Egyptians to change their hearts so they would let the people of the Israelites go, and Pharaoh still refused. And so God said to Moses, go and prepare the Israelite people. Tell them, tonight you're leaving. I'm bringing you out tonight. He said, I'm going to bring one last plague on the Egyptian people, and then I'll let you go. It's going to be the death of the firstborn. And God is going to said he's going to bring an angel of death that will go throughout the land of Egypt, and he will strike every home, and the firstborn in every home is going to die, and then Pharaoh will let you go. It's going to strike from the least important to the most important, even in Pharaoh's household that night. The firstborn was going to die. But God provided a way of escape, a way of protection for the Israelite people. If you remember, he had them slay a lamb and take the blood of the lamb and smear it on the doorposts of their homes. So that night when the death angel would pass over the land, if he saw the blood on the doorposts, and he would not bring death to that household, but if there was no blood over the doorposts, and death was going to come to the household that night. And that's exactly what happened that night. The Passover took place, and the angel of death passed over the land, but he passed over the households of the Israelites, and not one of the Israelites died that night. And that night, the Israelites were saved by the blood of the lamb and the blood on the doorposts. And thus began one of the most important of all Jewish observances, the Passover. And God made a decree for the Israelite people because of that great miracle, if you will, of deliverance, that every year the Israelite people at that time of year, they were to celebrate the Passover as a memorial, a reminder of what God had done for them. And so year after year after year, the Israelites would gather for the Passover in their homes. They would slay a lamb every year. They would eat the lamb. They would teach their children what Passover was all about. They would sing songs and they would pray prayers. And they would celebrate the Passover. And that's what's happening here in Mark chapter 14. Jesus and his disciples have gathered together to celebrate the Passover. And notice in verse 12, it says, on the first day of unleavened bread, when the Passover lamb was being sacrificed. Remember, a lamb had to be sacrificed for every household. And it's on this day in Mark chapter 14, verse 12, in which all the lambs are going to be slain. All of them had to be killed by sundown. And there are thousands upon thousands of people visiting in Jerusalem for Passover. And each one and each family is going to have a lamb they're going to bring to the priest to be slain. You can imagine thousands of thousands upon thousands of people there and thousands upon thousands of lambs being slaughtered. What an amazing celebration and memorial to God's delivery of Passover that had to be that day. But there were some problems. There were two issues that were going on with Passover. They're on your outline. Number one, it had lost its impact. It had lost its impact. The impact of its original celebration of Passover, that great miracle of deliverance. Oh, it probably impacted them for the first few years when they would have the Passover celebration and they would remind their family, this is to remember what God did when he delivered us out of Egypt and how he passed over that night because of the blood on the doorpost. And so for the first few years, it was a great celebration. But over time, it became routine. Oh, every year they had the same food, they had the same drink, they taught their children the same things, they sang the same songs, they said the same words, and it just became a routine. They still celebrated the Passover, but it lost its impact. You want to know why? Because it lost its wonder. It lost its wonder. The wonder of a God who would do such a miracle to save his people from bondage in Egypt, and a God who would save his people from death. They lost the wonder of it all. They took it all for granted. And you say, well, how could they lose the wonder of it all? How could they just take it all for granted? You want to know how? It's easy. They forgot. They forgot the wonder of the Passover. You say, well, how do you forget? Bring up Psalm 78, would you? Psalm 78, verse 11. There it is. Psalm 78 is a history of the Israelites and their being brought out of the bondage of Egypt and their wanderings through the wilderness and all the miracles that God did for them while they were wandering. And then you come to Psalm 78 and verse 11. It says they forgot what God had done, the wonders or the miracles that he had shown them. They forgot what he had done and the wonders that the miracles that he had shown them. You see what happened? They forgot about it all. They forgot the wonders, all the miracles that God had done. The miracle of of God dividing the sea so they could pass through on dry land. The miracle of God supplying the manna from heaven and the water out of the rock and all the other miracles. Even the miracle of Passover, they just forgot it. And you say, how do you forget a miracle? Well, don't get me wrong. They still remember the Passover, but they forgot the wonder of it all. You see that word forgot there? It's a Hebrew word that has two different aspects to it. Oh, it means to forget. But it's an interesting Hebrew word, two different aspects. On the one hand, it deals with action. This is not on your outline, so don't look for a place to put it in. On the one hand, it deals with action. In other words, it's not just that they just skipped their mind. They purposely chose not to remember the Passover and the miracle that God had done. They purposely chose not to remember it. And you know the reason why? Because the second word for remember, their second meaning of forgot, I should say, is the word full. It's the word full. They were full, so they forgot. That's what the word means. It means to be full, so you forget. Let me explain it this way. How many of you, when you woke up this morning, were hungry? I'm hungry all the time, so this morning was no difference. Who was hungry this morning? How many of you ate this morning before you came to church? Do you remember your hunger anymore now? That was a question. No, you don't remember it anymore. Why? Because you ate. You were hungry, but once you ate, then you forgot that you were hungry. That's what this word forget means, or forgot means in the Hebrew. It means to have something, to have a need, but then once you have that need met, it means to forget it because you forgot you have that need met already. For example, with the Israelites, they had a need of coming out of the bondage in Egypt. And they cried out to God, and God, save us, and oh, God, do something. But once God did that miracle and brought them out of the land of bondage, you know what? They forgot all about it. Not just their bondage, they forgot about the miracle God did. They forgot the wonder of it all. They still celebrated it, but they forgot the wonder of what God had done. You say, well, Pastor Larry, what's all this got to do with us? I think it's got a lot to do with us because I think we do the same thing with the Lord's Supper. The Lord's Supper is the decoration of our deliverance by God. It's a remembrance of that, of God doing a great miracle and bring us out of bondage. Not bondage to slavery in Egypt, but out of bondage to sin. And it's a reminder of God delivering us from death, not the physical death of that angel that night of the Passover, but of a spiritual death, of a separation from God for all of eternity. And each time we celebrate the Lord's Supper, we are remembering that deliverance of what God has done for us and the great miracle he's done for us. But I think many times, just like the Passover, it becomes routine. We just do it over and over again until it has no meaning. We just go through the motions of it. I knew someone that attended a church, and their church does Lord's Supper every Sunday. Nothing wrong with that. It doesn't tell us, the Bible doesn't tell us how many times do it. We do it once a month. They do it every Sunday. It doesn't matter. But what's interesting is what this person said to me. They said, we do it every month, and you know what? It's almost like a routine, like we hurry through it just to get through it so we can get the more important parts of the service. You know what they're saying. They're just going through the motions of it. It's just become a routine. And I think sometimes we do that with the Lord's Supper and the Christian life. It just becomes a routine. And you know why? Because I think we lose the wonder of our salvation. The wonder of God would deliver us, and God would die upon that cross with our sins, and God would forgive us of our sins, and the miracle of it all. I think somehow we just get used to it, and we just take it all for granted. And you know why? Because we become full, just like the Israelites. Oh, we had that great miracle of our salvation, and it was just so wonderful, but now, you know what? We've had that salvation. And now we become full, and we just lose that wonder. I've been a believer in Christ now for 45 years. And I remember back to 45 years ago on November the 11th, 1973, on a Sunday afternoon when I bowed beside my bed and I trusted in Jesus Christ as my Savior. I remember the wonder of it all. The wonder that God would die on that cross with my sins and he would give me forgiveness of my sins, eternal life, and I knew where I was going to go when I died. I just remember the wonder of it all and how amazing it was. But now I wonder, 45 years later, has that wonder diminished because I've had that salvation now for 45 years? Do you know what I'm saying? I wonder if it diminishes within us. See, the Lord's Supper that we're going to partake of in a little bit ought to be a celebration of the miracle of new birth. Let me ask you a question. What do you think is the greatest miracle that God's ever done? Some of you might say, well, it's creation when God just spoke and the universe came to being. I mean, that's pretty powerful. I think that's a great miracle. But I don't think that's the greatest miracle God's ever done. Some of you may say, well, maybe it's when God divided the sea so the Israelites could walk through and brought the water back over the Egyptians. Great miracle, but not the greatest. Or you say that maybe it's got to be when Christ fed the 5,000 with a few fish and a few loaves of bread. That was quite a miracle. But I don't think so. You say, well, maybe it's when Jesus Christ died on that cross and rose again. Maybe the resurrection is the greatest miracle. I think that's a great miracle, don't you? But I don't think it's the greatest. What do you think is the greatest miracle God's ever done? Saving us. Saving us from our sins. I think that's the greatest miracle that God has ever done. Is saving us from our sins and giving to us a new life. And I think today in the Lord's Supper, I'll be a celebration of that great miracle. So let me ask you a question this morning. What are you going to celebrate of your salvation today? If today with the Lord's Supper is to be a great celebration of our salvation and all that God's done for us, what are you going to celebrate? You need some help? Let me give you some things here. This is a list somebody has made of all the things that our salvation brings to us. Listen to some of these. I'm going to go through them fast, so you got to stay with me. Well, first of all, he's brought us from a sinner to a saint. He's brought us from one who was a slave to one who's redeemed, one who was a child of Satan to a child of God, one who was an enemy of God to now a friend of God, one who was dead to now one who is alive, one who faced condemnation to now one who enjoys forgiveness, one who faced an eternity in hell to one now has eternity in heaven, one who was blind to now one who can see, one who was separated from God and now brought near to God, one without hope now one full of hope, one who was lost now one who was found. One who had an eternal debt to now one whose debt has been paid in full. One who is of this world to now one who is only passing through this world. One whose master was Satan to now one whose master is Christ. One who is to be judged by his works to now one who never will face condemnation. One who walked alone to now one who now walks with God. And one who was once a condemner of Christ to now one who is a lover of Christ. One whose prayers were not answered to one whose now prayers are precious to God. One who was filthy to now one who is clean. One who was unrighteous, now one who declared to be righteous. One who was cursed, now one who is blessed. And it goes on. There's 45 things. I could spend more time reading them. But I don't know about you, but at this point, somebody ought to be saying amen. Or you know what? Instead of saying amen, I think we ought to fall to our knees in gratitude and wonder to God. We ought to fall to our knees and say, God, thank you. Because that's what the Lord's Supper is all about, friends. It's a reminder of the wonder of it all. There's an old song that goes, turn back the pages every now and then. Show me where I was and where I would have been. I pray this morning as you and I enjoy the Lord's Supper that God will take us back and show us where would we be without Jesus Christ today. See, that's why we should never lose the wonder of our salvation. Because of all that Jesus Christ had done for us and all undeserving. But that's also why we should never take the Lord's Supper for granted and just the routine, friends. There ought to be a wonder to it all, a celebration, if you will, a reminder of all that God has done, the miracle of new birth that he has given to us. Well, we're going to do that at the end of the service. But before we do that, secondly on your outline, we have to see the announcement of betrayal. The announcement of betrayal. You still with me? Good. We've got the celebration of Passover. It lost its impact and lost its wonder. But there's also the announcement of betrayal of Judas that night. Look at verses 12 through 21 with me. Stay with me. On the first day of unleavened bread, when the Passover lamb was being sacrificed, his disciples said to Jesus, where do you want us to go and prepare for you to eat the Passover? And Christ sent two of his disciples and said to him, you go into the city, and a man will meet you carrying a pitcher of water. Follow him, and wherever he enters, say to the owner of the house, the teacher says, where is my guest room in which I may eat the Passover with my disciples? And he himself will show you a large upper room furnished and ready, prepared for us there. And the disciples went out and came to the city and found it just as he had told them, and they prepared the Passover. And when it was evening, Christ came with the 12, and as they were reclining at the table and eating, Jesus said, "Truly I say to you that one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me." And they began to be grieved and to say to him one by one, "Surely not I." And Christ said to him, "It is one of the 12, one who dips with me in the bowl. For the Son of Man is to go, just as is written to him, but woe to that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been good for that man if he had not been born." And you say, well, Pastor, what in the world are we going to get out of this morning? Well, I think there's a lot here this morning in these verses. It tells us here that it was time for Jesus Christ and his disciples to celebrate the Passover. They had celebrated it before, but this time it was going to be different. Verse 13 says Jesus Christ sent two of his disciples to go and prepare the Passover. Now, tradition allowed for only two men to prepare the Passover lamb, to bring the lamb to the priest to be slaughtered. There are going to be thousands upon thousands of people in the city of Jerusalem, and everyone was going to need a lamb to be slaughtered. So you can imagine the chaos that was going to be in that city. So only two men were allowed to bring the lamb to the priest. And we know from the other scriptures that Peter and John were chosen by Jesus Christ to take the lamb to be slaughtered, and they would have taken the lamb to the priests. And the priest would have taken that lamb and slain the lamb and poured the blood of that lamb on the altar and saved some of the meat of the lamb to be burned as a sacrifice to God. Then they would have given the rest of the meat back to Peter and John to go and prepare the Passover meal. In verse 12, the disciples asked Jesus Christ, "Where do you want us to go and prepare the Passover meal?" Don't miss this. Look at verse 13. Look at his response. And he sent two of his disciples and said to him, "Go into the city, and a man will meet you carrying a pitcher of water. Follow him. And wherever he enters, say to the owner of the house, 'The teacher says, where is my guest room in which I may eat the Passover with my disciples?'" Now that's an interesting response by Jesus Christ. Disciples ask him, "Where do you want us to go and prepare the Passover meal?" And you think he would tell them, "Oh, you go to such and such an address. Go to 638 Paris Island Gateway and do it there." But Christ didn't give him a specific address to a house to go to, did he? He didn't even tell him a street to go to. He didn't even tell him what part of Jerusalem to go to. He simply said to him, "You'll see a man. When you're in the city, you're going to see a man carrying water, and you follow him." What kind of answer is that? Well, it's a very clear answer. Because, you see, men didn't carry water in these days. Only women did. That was women's work. That would be politically correct today, wouldn't it? Only women carried water, and so if they found a man carrying water, then that would be highly unusual. It would probably be only one man in the entire city of Jerusalem carrying water, and so they would know that's the man that they were to follow. And Christ says, verse 13 and 14, "You follow him, and whatever house he enters, you go in and say, 'The teacher says, where is my guest room in which I may eat the Passover with my disciples?' And he'll show you a large upper room." Why did Christ do that? Why didn't he just tell him which house to go to? Why did he keep it in such suspense? You got any ideas? I don't hear anything. I think it's because of Judas. I think he was trying to keep Judas from knowing where they were going to eat the Passover. See, remember, Judas had already gone to the priests, and he had already agreed to betray Jesus Christ, and they were looking for a time when Jesus and his disciples would be alone away from the crowds, because they thought if they arrest Christ when the crowds are around, the crowds will riot. So they looked for a time when Jesus Christ would be alone that they could arrest him. And what better time than when he and his disciples are eating the Passover lamb, Passover meal by themselves? Everybody would be in their households. No one would even know. And the scripture says that Jesus Christ greatly desired to have his last supper with his disciples, so he kept the location secret. Now, verse 17, when it was evening, Christ came with his 12 disciples to celebrate the Passover meal. And look at verse 18, as they were reclining at the table and eating. You see the word reclining there? It is a Greek word that doesn't mean they were sitting. I know we see the paintings of the Last Supper. Who did that? It's a masterpiece. Who did that? Was it Da Vinci? Leonardo da Vinci did that painting of the Last Supper and Christ and all the disciples sitting on the other side of the table. Now, it's a beautiful painting, and some of you have it hanging in your house, but it's totally wrong. They didn't sit at a table. It says they're reclining at the table. The word reclining is a Greek word that means they were on the floor. They were laying on mats on the floor close to the ground, and they would be in a circle, and they would have a small table in the middle. So they would lean upon their elbows on that mat, and they would all be in a circle on those mats on the floor. That's going to be important in just a few moments. So they're eating the Passover meal. In verse 18, suddenly Jesus Christ makes a startling statement. He says, "Truly I say to you that one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me." Suddenly in the midst of this great celebration of the Passover, Christ makes an unusual, startling statement. One of you guys is going to betray me. Can you imagine their reaction to hearing that? They couldn't believe it. In fact, verse 19 says they were grieved. The word grieved means to be saddened. It means to be distressed. It means to be shocked. They're shocked that one of them would betray him. I think they just probably, when Christ said that, they're just so much shocked, their mouth just dropped open, and they were just silent for a little bit. Then verse 19, they all asked Jesus Christ the same question. Look at the question they asked him. "Surely not I. Surely not me, Jesus." Now, we would pass over that question there in verse 19 so quickly as if it's not important, but I would tell you, it's a penetrating question, friends. Because that question, "surely not I," in the Greek language, can be asked in two different ways. On the one hand, it can be asked with a note of confidence, as if to say, "Surely it's not me, Jesus. I'm not going to do that." That's one way. On the other hand, it can be asked with a sense of doubt, as if to say, "It's not me, is it, Jesus? Am I the one that's going to betray you?" You say, well, why would they even ask that question? Because each one of them knew deep down inside the evil that existed in their hearts. And each one of them, deep down inside, knew they had the capability of betraying Jesus Christ. You say, why bring that up? Because we all have that same sense inside of us, don't we? We all have that evil inside of us that we know we could betray Jesus Christ. Oh, not like Judas did. But we all could betray Jesus Christ. We all could have a moment when we could identify with the name of Jesus Christ in the midst of a group of people and we fail to do it. We all know what it's like to betray Jesus Christ when we desire the praise and the recognition, the approval of other people more than Jesus Christ. And we all know what it's like to know what the will of God is, what Christ wants us to do in our lives. And we do the opposite. We've all been there, haven't we? We all know what it's like to look back over our lives and wonder, how in the world could I have done that? How in the world could I have said that? How in the world could I have thought that? We've all been there. We've had times in our lives when we felt like we were so spiritual that if Christ asked us, we could walk on water like Peter. And then a few moments later, just like Peter, we have such unbelief that we would begin to sink. We all know what it's like to praise Jesus Christ with our lips and just a few moments later with those same lips to cut somebody else down. And we all know what it's like to one moment feel like we're so strong that we could walk in obedience to Christ and the next moment fail him so badly. We've all been there. You say, what are you getting at? Well, number one on your outline, there's no room for boasting this morning. There's no room for boasting, no room for boasting at the Lord's Supper of how spiritual we are. Because number two, there's no room for self. There's no room for self. Look at verse 20 with me. Christ sought to assure the disciples that they would not betray him. So he says, verse 20, it's the one of the 12, the one who dips with me in the bowl. Christ said, it's not going to be all of you. It's just the one who dips with me in the bowl. That's the one that's going to betray me. Remember, they're not sitting at a table. They're sitting in a circle. And Christ says, the one who dips with me in the bowl, that's the one who is able to dip with Christ into a bowl. What they would do is take their bread and they would dip it in a bowl of spices or oil and then eat it. So you got to ask the question, how many of those disciples could dip in a bowl with Jesus Christ? How many? Got any idea? They're in a circle, so how many? Two. One on each side. One on the right and one on the left. And we know from the Gospels that John is on one side, and we know who's on the other side. Judas is. And Judas is going to betray Jesus Christ. He's going to dip in that bowl and with the bread with Jesus, and he's going to eat it, but he's going to betray Jesus Christ. And so Christ says in verse 21, the Son of Man is going to go just as is written of him, but woe to that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. it would have been good for that man if he had not been born. And John tells us in his gospel at that moment that Satan entered into Judas and Judas left to betray Jesus Christ. And you got to stop at this moment. And you got to ask the question, why would Judas betray Jesus Christ? Why would he do it? And the easy answer is to say, oh, it's Satan. Well, Satan entered him. That's what John says. So it had to be Satan. And that's part of it. Satan is behind part of this, but you've got to remember that Judas had already made a deal with the religious officials that he would betray Jesus even before Satan entered him. So that may be part of it, but that's not the whole reason. You say, well, it's got to be greed because the religious officials offered to give him 30 pieces of silver if he betrayed Jesus. I think that's part of it, but what else? I think it's because Judas, also you could say Judas, because he had all these expectations. He may have thought Jesus was going to establish his kingdom on earth right then, and he's disappointed with Jesus. Yeah, that could be a part of it. There could be a lot of reasons. But you know what I would think it was at the core of why Judas betrayed Jesus? I think it was a focus upon himself. It was focus upon himself. And he left that night because he has a focus upon himself, because there's no room at the Lord's Supper for a focus upon self. There was no room for Judas that night and a focus on self at that supper, and there's no room for focus upon self today. There's no room in your life and mine to focus upon ourselves and our wants and our desires, our dreams, our demands. It's not about us in the Christian life. It's about Jesus Christ. But I'll also tell you, at the Lord's Supper, there's no room for self today and a focus upon self. There's no room as we celebrate the Lord's table, the Lord's Supper today, to focus upon self and self-righteousness. There's no room today for you and I to focus on how spiritual we think we are and how pleased we think God must be with us. And there's no room at the Lord's Supper today to focus upon how other people must be thinking we are just wonderful. And there's no room today at the Lord's Supper to focus upon ourselves and how much we do for the kingdom of God, how valuable we must be to God. You understand what I'm saying? There's no room for self today. No room at all. I remember years ago, Linda and I going to a historic church. I think it was in Williamsburg, Virginia. And as we walked in, and there was a guide there, and he was telling everybody about this church, and George Washington and other presidents had worshiped there, and he's telling about the church, and I looked down in the first few pews. They had pews, and they had doors on them, and they were locked. I thought, I've never seen anything like that. And I said, why are these doors locked? And he said, because back in those days, you know, the important people got to buy those pews, and they got to sit in there, and it was locked, and they had a key to open it. So what were they saying about those people? They're more important. They're the spiritual people. They're the people that are important in this church. It's not just in history. I remember being in seminary at Grace Seminary, considered to be one of the top seminaries in the country at that time. And I remember we had these guys that thought that they were the top of the seminary, that somehow they were more spiritual. They were better than any other students there. We used to call them God's gift to the church. Somehow they thought they were better than the rest of us. What's interesting, I know two of them failed miserably in their first ministry. But they thought somehow they were better than the rest of us. But it's not just churches, not just seminary students. Pastors are some of the worst ones. I remember years back sitting with a group of pastors. It was supposed to be a fellowship, and they're going around, and you just get the impression they just think that somehow their church is the best church there is. I had a church about 1,300 at that time, and I thought, you know what, my church is bigger than yours. Who cares? Do you know what I mean? Who cares what size church is? Nothing happens outside of the grace of God anyways. God takes his hand off a church, that's the end of it. It's not just pastors. Christians do it, don't we? We've all been around people that think somehow that they're better than anybody else. Somehow they're more spiritual. Somehow they do more for the kingdom of God. Can I tell you what God thinks of all that? He says it's all a bunch of baloney. That's the Greek word for foolishness, if you didn't know. Now, seriously, want to know what God says? You know what God thinks of us? He says we're all sinners saved by grace. No one better than anyone else. All sinners saved by grace. And he says all of our good works are what? Filthy rags. We're all on the same level. See, at the cross of Jesus Christ, the ground is level. No one better than anyone else. And can I tell you, at the Lord's Supper, the ground is level. No one better than anyone else. No one higher. No one more important. No one more spiritual than anything else. We're all there by the very grace of God. And that's what the Lord's Supper ought to be today. It ought to be a celebration of the very grace of God in our lives. Not focusing upon how important we must be to the kingdom of God or how pleased God must be with us. It's coming before Him and saying, Lord, thank you. Thank you for your grace. You see, on your outline, there's no room for self. There's only room for grace. There's only room for grace. Maybe you came here today and you were thinking about how spiritual you are and how important you are. Forget it. Leave it at the door, friends. It's not true. Or maybe you came here today and you're feeling like a failure. And maybe you feel like you're just struggling daily to be the person God wants you to be and growing a little bit day by day. You know what? You're not alone. We're all there, aren't we? It's all by the grace of God. Because none of us would have any standing before God except for the cross of Jesus Christ and the very grace of God. And that's what the Lord's Supper, that's what we celebrate. You know, I know we know that. But my heart this morning, my prayer this morning is that we would just grab a hold of that afresh. And remind ourselves this morning, there's no room for boasting at the Lord's Supper. There's no room for self. There's only room for grace. And that leads us to the third part about the celebration of the Lord's Supper. Join me in verses 22 to 24, would you? In the simplicity of the Lord's Supper. While they were eating, Christ took some bread, and after a blessing, he broke it, and he gave it to them, and he said, take it, this is my body. And when he had taken a cup and given thanks, he gave it to them, and they all drank from it, and he said to them, this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. In these three verses, we have Jesus Christ introducing what we would call the Lord's Supper of the bread and the cup. Now, some have tried to claim there was something special about the bread or something special about the cup. There was nothing special about them. It was just part of the bread of the Passover meal and just a cup of very watered-down wine that they had at the meal. The wonder of it all is in what they symbolize, friends. For example, on your outline there, the bread symbolized the sacrifice of Jesus Christ, the sacrifice of his life, the Christ who is God would leave heaven and he would be born in a stable and take upon him the form of a man, and one day he would die on that cross as a sacrifice for your sins and mine. And you say, why? Because the sacrifice for the sins had to be perfect. There could be no spot, there could be no blemish, and the Bible is clear that we've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. All of us are imperfect, but Jesus Christ, who was God, lived a perfect life, and on that cross he died with your sins and mine, and he was a sacrifice for our sins. And every time we celebrate the Lord's Supper and we partake of that bread, we all remind ourselves, this reminds me that Jesus Christ died for me. He took my place. When I was yet a sinner, Christ took my place upon that cross. And secondly, it says in verse 23 that Christ took the cup, a cup of very watered-down wine. That's all it was. But he says in verse 24, this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. It was a reminder, it was symbolic of the blood of the covenant that God was offering. That through the blood of Jesus Christ and his blood shed upon that cross for our sins, that we could be saved from our sins. It's all so simple, isn't it? This is my body. This is my blood. So simple, but so amazing. But I wonder today, do we comprehend all that cost Jesus Christ to be our sacrifice? You see the cup there? Do we understand the cup that Christ drank that day upon the cross and all that it involved? Let me share with you three things this morning just to remind us. Number one, it was a cup of suffering. A cup of suffering, a physical suffering. Historians tell us that the crucifixion was one of the cruelest deaths that mankind had ever come up with. And the agony would be amazing that the person would go through on that cross. And I wish I had time today to read you an historical account of what would have happened to Jesus Christ and his body and all the physical suffering that he would have gone through, but I don't have time for it. But I do want to tell you this morning that Christ went through great physical suffering, and he drank every ounce of that cup of suffering. And you know why he did it? He did it for you and for me. That should have been your cross and mine. That should have been our agony. That should have been our suffering that he went through. But Christ took all of it so that you and I would never have to go through that physical suffering. It was a cup of suffering, but as bad as that was, what was worse, it was a cup of sin. It was a cup of sin. Because on that cross, Jesus Christ took all of our sins upon him, and he died with them. You mean he took the judgment and the wrath of God? Yes, but it's more than that. When Jesus Christ died on that cross, your sins and mine were laid to his account. See, in order for Christ to become the sacrifice for our sins had to be laid to his account as if he had done it. So every sin that you and I have ever committed was laid on Jesus Christ upon that cross, as if he had done it. So on that cross, Jesus Christ became a liar because you and I lie. On that cross, Jesus Christ became bitter because you and I are bitter. On that cross, Jesus Christ became selfish. He became a prostitute. He became an alcoholic. He became a drug abuser. Whatever you and I have ever done, Jesus Christ became on that cross. And remember, he's a holy God, perfect in his holiness. Can you even begin to comprehend the suffering he went through as a holy God when our sins were laid to his account as if he accomplished them? And the agony was so much greater than the physical agony. The spiritual agony that Jesus Christ felt upon that cross was even greater. But even that wasn't as hard as the cup of separation, which he also drank. The cup of separation. Because when Jesus Christ died upon that cross, God the Father had to turn his back on God the Son. God is a holy God. He cannot allow sin in his presence. He cannot look upon it. So when Jesus Christ bore your sins and mine upon that cross, God the Father turned his back on God the Son. And for the first time in eternity, the fellowship that God the Father and God the Son had was broken. That's hard to comprehend. But we know from the words from the cross when Jesus cried out and he said, my God, why have you forsaken me? That word forsaken is a Greek word that speaks of being alienated, of being abandoned, of being separated. And Christ at that moment felt the abandonment of the Father when he died with your sins in mind upon that cross. He did it all, friends, so that you and I would never have to face that separation. And that's what the cup of the Lord's Supper reminds us of. It's not just the time just to go through the motions of a routine so we can get on to more important things. Every time we partake of that cup of the Lord's Supper, it's a reminder of the sufferings physically Christ went through and the suffering spiritually when he bore our sin on that cross and of the separation that he faced. One more part here. The last two words. He said, this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. You see that word, many? Who's he talking about? You say, well, the 12 disciples. Yeah, Judas. Yeah, even Judas who would sin against him and betray him. How about all mankind? Yeah, many involves all mankind, but who else does it involve? Who else is it including there, friends? Come on, think about it. Who else? All mankind, who else? Us, me, you, you, and you, and you, and you, and you, and you, and those of you at Bluffton, and those of you at Graniteville, and those of you at Gray's, it's you too. It's us. We make it the world. Yeah, Christ died for the world, but make it personal. He died for me and you. He did all that for you. In fact, turn to someone around you and say, Christ died for me. Would you do that? Don't lose it. Don't lose that sense of the personalness of the cross of Jesus Christ. Because I think when we understand the personalness of that cross of Jesus Christ, I think we'll never lose the wonder of our salvation. And I think if we can understand and remember the personalness of the cross of Jesus Christ, then we'll never just go through the routine and the motions of the Lord's Supper. Because when you understand all of that, and you understand it was for you and for me, then it fills your heart with wonder. Are you ready to celebrate the Lord's Supper? But before we do, I've got to ask you, do you know Christ as your Savior? Has there ever come a time in your life when you, by faith, put your trust in Christ as your Savior? The Bible says we've all sinned. We're all separated from God, facing an eternity from Him. But it's very clear He died for you on that cross. And you can know Christ's forgiveness right now before you leave this room. It comes by faith when you receive the free gift of Christ's salvation. Let's pray together, can we? And maybe you're here today and you've never trusted in Jesus Christ as your Savior. And you say, Pastor Larry, I don't know if I was to die today that I'd immediately go into the presence of God. You can right now. If by faith you will trust in Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord. And one way you can express that faith in Christ is through prayer. And so if you're here this morning and you've never trusted in Christ as your Savior and you want to do it right now, then I'm going to ask you to pray after me if these words express the belief in your heart. Just silently, right where you're sitting, pray and say, Lord Jesus, I confess to you that I'm a sinner and I need a Savior. And I thank you for dying with my sins on that cross. And right now, I trust in you as my Savior and Lord. And the Bible says if you were sincere in that prayer, then right now, your sins are forgiven. Right now, Christ is your Savior, and from this moment on, you have eternity with God. Our Father God, this morning, we are grateful for Christ. Grateful for new life in Him. We celebrate your grace and your mercy, and we give you thanks today. And it's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen. Would you stand, please? And maybe you're here this morning, you've trusted in Jesus Christ as your Savior today or in recent days. We believe the Bible teaches that after you trust in Christ, you make it public. And one way you can make it public is by coming down the aisle and meeting me here at the front. We want to talk to you about your Christian life. Coming down the aisle doesn't save you. It's trusting in Christ, but we believe you make it public. If you've never made it public, then you come as we sing, please. Or maybe you're here and you've trusted in Christ as your Savior, but you've never been baptized since you trusted in Christ. We believe baptism, the Bible teaches, comes after salvation. It's an outward sign of what's happened inwardly. It's a declaration to the world that Christ is your Savior. And if you've never been baptized since you trusted in Christ as your Savior, you come as well, and we'll set that up. Or maybe you're here this morning, you want to be a member here at Community Bible Church. You come as we sing as well, please.
Sing together, here is love.
Here is love, vast as the ocean, loving kindness as the flood. When the Prince of Life, our ransom, shed for us His precious blood. Through His love, we'll not remember, who can cease to sing His praise. He can forgotten throughout heaven's eternal days. On the mount of crucifixion, fountains open deep and wide. Through the floodgates of God's mercy flowed a vast and gracious tide. Grace and love from above, heaven's peace and perfect justice kissed a guilty world in love.
Please be seated. My prayer this morning to God was, God, bring a fresh sense to us this morning of the wonder of our salvation. Help us not to take the Lord's Supper just as a routine. I don't know if I've done that. It's so easy just to go through the motions of it, isn't it? The Lord's Supper doesn't save us. It doesn't become the body and the blood of Christ, but it's a reminder of all that he's done for us. That bread is a reminder of that sacrifice when you and I were imperfect sinners, the Bible says, and incapable of doing anything about it. And Christ came and he took that sin that you and I commit upon the cross and all the judgment, all the wrath of God, he paid it. So you and I never would have to. And I don't know about you, but that's amazing to me. I guess what's hit me over the years as a believer in Christ is how unworthy I am for his salvation. Oh, not as a self-righteousness. I was a sinner needing a Savior. And the very one I had sinned against is the very one who died for me upon that cross. How do you explain that? Except the amazing love of our Lord. I'm going to ask the gentleman to come with the bread now. And when the bread is passed, would you just take a piece? And remember earlier I said, where would you be without Christ? Remember that song? Turn back the pages every now and then. Show me where I was and where I would have been. So as the bread is passed, just take a piece and then just think for a few moments, where would I be without Christ? Thank you, William. Thank you. William. Body of Christ broken for you. Body of Christ. Would you be without Jesus Christ? There's no forgiveness, no heaven awaiting you. There's no peace with God. There's no peace in life. There's no joy. There's no hope. There's nothing. But oh my, what a difference. Because now in Christ, there's eternity awaiting us with God. The moment we die, we go into his presence. There's hope for a life of a God who reigns, who walks with us in life. There's his peace, his joy. There's forgiveness of sins. There's all of that. It's just a cracker. But it symbolizes so much more. Pray with me, would you? Thank you. While we were yet sinners and your enemies, you died on that cross for us. You took our place. That should have been our cross, our suffering, our agony. But today we want to say thank you and we celebrate your sacrifice for us. And we do so in your name. Amen. Then he took the cup. Just a cup of watered down wine. He passed it around and said, take a drink of it, every one of you. That cup would symbolize the next day and the cup that he would drink upon that cross. Memory said, Father, remove this cup from me, yet not my will, but yours. A cup of great suffering. Agony that we can't even begin to fathom. But then a cup of sin. When your sins and mine were laid to his account as if he had done them all. But friends, it's that cup of separation I can't get away from. I could never comprehend turning my back on my sons. I would never do that, and yet God would turn his back on his son. Why? For you and for me. So that we would never face that. Simply a cup of juice. But it's so much more. Gentlemen, would you come? And as the cup is passed, if you would take a cup and just bow for a few moments and just imagine what it had to be like for Jesus Christ upon that cross to be separated from the Father. Simply a cup of juice, a reminder of so much more. You know, I've found in counseling that we remember all the times we failed in life. It's rather interesting. Our mind just remembers those so clearly. I remember talking to one of my sons last year, and I said, Brian, we were talking about something in his childhood. I said, you know, Brian, I'm sorry, I failed you that time. I didn't come through for you. He goes, what are you talking about, Dad? I don't even remember that. And I realized, it came home to me, we remember our failures, but, you know, our kids don't even remember them many times. But here's the neat thing. You know, we remember our failures in our spiritual lives, our Christian lives, but God says because of the blood of Christ, they're all gone. They're all covered. They're all forgiven. He doesn't remember them. And so this cup is a remembrance, a reminder of that, of our forgiveness of our sins. And through, before the eyes of a holy God, we are clean and forgiven now through Jesus Christ. And I don't know about you, but I think that's pretty wonderful. Let's pray together, can we? Thank you for your blood. Thank you for on that cross, drinking that cup of suffering and of sin and separation for me and for each one of us, so that we would never have to. And today we want to say thank you, Lord. And today we just want to say we love you, Lord. Right, everyone? And it's in your name. Amen. I'm going to ask the gentlemen to come as we receive the morning offering. If you're here as a guest, please, you don't need to give anything. Just place that connect card in there, and we'd love to send you some information about the ministry here and the opportunities you have available to you here. Let's pray together. Our Father and our God, this morning we give you thanks. Thank you for our salvation, certainly, but also thank you for everything you've done for us. You've been so good. We give you thanks, and now we have the privilege of worshiping you through part of what you've given to us. We do so in worship, and in Christ's name, amen.
How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that He should give His only Son to make a wretch His treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns His face away, as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Sing, behold the man. Behold the man upon a cross, my sin upon His shoulders. Ashamed I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. Sing, I will not boast. I will not boast in anything. No gifts, no power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, His death and resurrection. Why should I gain from His reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know. I know.